that thoroughly because of room problems and that. We're happy to have Dr. Virgil Davis here with us today to speak on hypothermia. He did his residency at the University of Arizona at Tucson and also worked in a small community hospital in Northern California. And we're just happy to hear you.
Thanks, Russ. Ready to go? So today we're going to talk about hypothermia and specifically environmental hypothermia. I'm not going to talk about post-cardiac arrest hypothermia. That's a talk in and of itself. So on the slides, I'm going to go through some background about hypothermia, some pathophysiology, the clinical presentation, and then that stuff I think is good background information. I like to go through, people can gain from it what they like, but then I really want to focus on a very little bit of stuff that actually everybody needs to be able to know and kind of memorize or whatever, which is the treatment and changes to ACLS guidelines. And there's not a lot of stuff there, so it's pretty directed information. The reason I bring that up is if, you know, you're like, wow, this is too much stuff in the background and so forth, just take from it what you want, and then at the end I'll kind of point out what I think are really the important things. And then sort of a quick wrap-up. And so some background information, just a lot of this is, the history is from military engagements. There's a lot of interesting stuff written about hypothermia. So this is a depiction of Hannibal crossing the Alps with the elephants here. He lost about half his troops to hypothermia crossing the Alps back in 218 BC. And then to more modern times, it still has tended to be a pretty big killer for military engagements. This is the, kind of the classic, some classic pictures from Napoleon's war. He went into Russia with about 400,000 to 600,000 troops going in, and only 10 to 20,000 came out in negative 30 degree Celsius weather. So really a lot of deaths due to hypothermia and nutrition and so forth. Same thing happened in World War I and World War II. 200,000 troops were reported to be lost to hypothermia and other cold-related illnesses in each war. So that was sort of the historical perspective. You know, now, not so much a disease of military encounters, but mostly the urban poor and the elderly, and then to a smaller degree, outdoor recreationalists. And although we often think of it as, you know, maybe avalanche victims and so forth, there was actually a case series from Utah looking at who died from hypothermia a few years ago, and it was all urban deaths. It wasn't outdoor recreationalists. So certainly the outdoor recreationalists are at risk, but we really got to think about it in our elderly and then people that are socioeconomically disadvantaged and can't you know, have shelter and so forth during colder times of the year. So a little bit of background. What is hypothermia? I guess since we're talking about it, we should probably define it. And so basically it's defined as a decrease in body temperature to the point that the body is no longer able to do its natural functions. And that's really probably more important than any specific temperature, but just that the body's no longer to kind of keep warm and you're not, people aren't able to mentate, their cardiovascular system's impaired, and so forth. And but we generally do define it to start around 35 degrees Celsius. And again, you don't have to memorize any of these numbers. That's just sort of the general place that we consider it to start. So normal physiology as far as heat goes, we all sort of know that 98.6 Fahrenheit is the normal body temperature. The way this is that we keep warm, shivering is sort of the mechanical way that we keep warm. It can increase your heat production up to about 4 times. Once you get down to between 30 and 32 degrees, your body stops shivering, so at that point you're not really able to produce heat anymore. Food metabolism leads to heat production, and so obviously having access to food and being able to eat and digest and so forth is important to maintain your body temperature. Activity, so you know, doing jumping jacks or running around and so forth. Actually, muscle contraction is thought to be less important than the shivering response as far as generating heat. But then the most important in humans is behavioral. So things that we do to keep warm, like putting on clothing, turning up the heat, getting into an environment that's not leading to exposure, taking off wet clothing and so forth. And this one's important because most people that end up hypothermic have impaired behavioral responses, and that's impaired by alcohol, drug abuse are two big ones. Illness, so people that are sick and can't really do the activities that they need to do to keep warm. Injury, trauma, burns, and so forth. and then age, either really young or really old. And so those are the people that are at risk for hypothermia. And again, we see it with the urban poor. They can't get to the environment that they need to be warm. People with drug and alcohol abuse also no longer do the behaviors that they need to do to keep warm. And
They're only showing the camera of you.
Oh, you guys can't see my slides. That's unfortunate. So what should we start over again? That seems like a pain. Okay. Good. The rest of the slides will go on then. Are we good? Okay. You guys missed all the cool pictures of Hannibal and the elephants. I'm going to go back. All right, here's Hannibal and the elephants. Here we go. Here's Napoleon's troops being escorted by Russian peasants to be killed. Here's a World War II vintage picture. Okay, that was it. Okay, so we talked about that. So risk factors, just to kind of, I guess we just went over these, but again, think of it in your elderly patients, especially ones that aren't mentating right and are sick from some other reason. Think about them being hypothermic. Think about children, small children, especially ones that are infected. They oftentimes will be hypothermic. Anybody that's drunk or abusing drugs, especially if they're sort of, you know, found down in the doorway to the local, you know, bar or out in the street corner somewhere, a lot of these people are severely hypothermic. We had a lady that got brought in a couple weeks ago that was, you know, found down and drunk, that had a core body temperature of 28 degrees Celsius. I mean, she was severely hypothermic. So think about it in those patients. Think about it in people that have heat loss. So burns are a big one. A lot of heat is lost in burn patients, and those patients are a lot of risk for hypothermia. Immersion, so obviously this one's kind of obvious, I guess, cold water. Obviously avalanche victims that are buried under the snow. And then anybody that's just sort of left out, or lost in the woods, or, you know, they're out overnight because they're homeless, whatever. Think about hypothermia. And then thermal regulatory problems. So that sounds fancy. Anybody that's got a neurologic diagnosis, and you don't even need to know what it is. They got Parkinson's or ALS multiple sclerosis or any kind of neurologic disorder. Think about them being hypothermic when they get sick, when you pick them up. Anybody that's got a traumatic brain injury, living out in the community, think about them as not being able to regulate their body temperature. Anybody that's in a wheelchair that has a spinal cord injury, they're very poor at regulating body temperature. Diabetics are at risk for this. And then anybody that, you know, seems to be infected or sick. Nursing home patients are definitely going to be in a risk group for hypothermia, even though they're inside. So this I'm going to go through again. None of this is stuff that you got to like sit and try to memorize, because a lot of it. But CNS, the kind of classic description is this sort of faraway gaze, slurred speech, slowed mentation, kind of irritability. And that's something important to recognize, both for work and also if you guys, you know, anybody participates in sort of outdoor activities in the winter. People sort of get this glazed look. They're just sort of slowed and just not processing right, maybe a little crabby. Those are kind of classic symptoms of hypothermia. By the time you get down to about 30 degrees, generally people are in a coma, not always. That lady we had a couple weeks ago that was 28 was talking to us, and she had a BL of like 400. So it's amazing what people can do, but in general, less than 30 degrees, people are usually obtunded or comatose. These effects get better very quickly when you warm people. So if they're cold and they're having mental status changes because they're cold and you warm them up, you would expect them to come around very quickly. Cardiovascular effects. Initially, people will get tachycardic as they try to compensate for being cold. But then once they get severely hypothermic, they get bradycardic, and their heart rates can be about half of their normal heart rate. This gets better when you warm people, but not as quickly. So it may take some time to see this come back up again. Respiratory, again, initially they may pick up their respiratory rate as their body tries to compensate, but as people get severely hypothermic, they have very low respiratory rates, as low as 5 breaths a minute or even less. Part of it is they don't need to breathe as much because their metabolism is slowed, and part of it is they can't breathe as fast. And this is something we'll want to address when we talk about treatment. And then just as a thing to remember is coagulation. All this stuff that makes your body clot blood stops working when it gets cold. So your platelets don't work, your coagulation factors don't work. These people are at risk to bleed very easily, if not be able to stop bleeding when they are bleeding. Something to think about, especially when we talk about intubating people and how we do that. Okay, so talking about some EKG or monitor strip findings. Anybody want to tell me what we're looking at here from the audience? You guys? Nope. Yeah, so it almost looks like an ST elevation MI, but what this is called is an Osborne wave. And that's sort of a classic finding in hypothermia. And so for everybody looking at this, you see, actually we see a couple of things. They're bradycardic, so that's the side effect of the hypothermia. Maybe as you look sort of on the left, right under where it says V1 and V2, maybe that's a P wave with a really long interval. So people's PR increases and they can have a heart block, first degree heart block. And then their QRS will widen, so it looks almost like a ventricular beat. And then they get this thing that looks like an elevated ST sign, but it's pretty distinctive looking, and I'll show you the next slide here. That's called an Osborne wave. And that generally is in severe hypothermia. So 28 degrees, 30 degrees, somewhere at this severe level, people start seeing these Osborne waves. And so if you see that, that's a pretty good sign that that patient's severely hypothermic. So I think we talked about here, so the PR interval we talked about, the QRS, the bradycardia looks like an agonal rhythm. I guess it sort of is, but it's due to the hypothermia. And this is important because this can be, you may need to check for 30 or 45 seconds to pick up a pulse in these people because they're so bradycardic. And then V-fib is an EKG change, I guess. That's kind of a bad one. Can happen spontaneously, but usually it's something induced. So the myocardium is very sensitive because it's cold, doesn't like being cold. And if you bang people, you jar them, you're rough with them, which unfortunately sometimes, you know, moving people is something that does jar patients, that can send them into V-fib. So it's really important to be very careful with patients, very gentle. Probably better to drive smoothly rather than quickly for these folks because it's been even reported like bumpy roads and stuff can trigger this V-fib, which is kind of scary. It's not been reported related simply to intubation, contrary to what we used to think. So just sort of classifying hypothermia, again, these aren't things that are necessarily this important, but mild hypothermia, so when you start getting cold, what do? You shiver, you start pacing around, your cardiac output goes up, your heart rate goes up, you start breathing faster, your body's trying to warm itself. It can only do it, your body isn't able to warm itself in cold temperatures that well, so if you're sort of naked out in the cold, all these things aren't going to cut it, but your body does try. Combined with insulation and clothing, this is how we keep warm when we're out in the cold environment. Once you get to a moderate hypothermia, this is sort of what we call an adynamic phase, so your body stops compensating at this point, and you stop shivering, your heart rate and respiratory rate return back to normal. And at this point, just covering people up and insulating them isn't going to lead to them getting warmer because they're not making their own heat at this point. And this is generally reported 30 to 34 degrees centigrade. And then severe, this is sort of the bad one. Once you hit about 30 degrees, everything just sort of shuts down. Drugs don't work anymore. Defibrillation probably doesn't work. Pacing doesn't work. And you can't make any heat whatsoever. You're what they call poikilothermic. You assume the temperature of your surroundings. And this is kind of the critical stage of hypothermia. If you guys have questions too, holler. Okay. So do we really need to remember all these stages? Luckily the answer is no, because I can't remember them. I have to look them up. Basically, the most clinically useful stage to remember is this 30-degree or severe hypothermia cutoff, because that's where your management for people is going to change when you pick them up. And so if you can measure core temperatures, this is a good number to remember. The same thing if you think they're hypothermic and they're either comatose or obtunded, they're real bradycardic, they're not shivering, but they're really cold to the touch, and maybe have Osborne waves, maybe their pupils are fixed and dilated, because that will happen, maybe they have V-fib. I mean, these are all signs of severe hypothermia. So somebody that, you know, is at risk for it, is palpably cold, and then has some of these symptoms, you can sort of presume are probably severely hypothermic. And this is where we're going to change our ACLS guidelines, which we're going to talk about in a second. So that's sort of the one, I guess, cutoff that I think is worth remembering. So treatment is remove, examine, insulate, and transport. So remove. Get them out of the cold environment. And if they have wet clothing on, get the wet clothing off the patient and replace it with dry insulation, which we'll talk about, because that wet material conducts heat extremely well, and the water can evaporate even in a cold temperature if it's dry. And so that's the best way to cool somebody is have them wet and cold. And we don't want to cool these people, so you got to get them out of all these wet clothing. Examine them, so you get them out of their wet clothes and look at them and find out what else is going wrong. Are they burned? They have a trauma? Are they in respiratory failure? Whatever. And then as soon as you're done examining them, we have to insulate people because they're just going to keep on losing heat. And there's a bunch of different ways, and I imagine every agency has sort of got their own setup for this. But blankets, warm blankets, a lot of agencies have these thermal bubble wrap type blankets that are really good insulators. In general, the best described way is to start with some sort of a barrier that's going to be a barrier to evaporation and wind. So that's like plastic that goes down. Insulating material goes on top of that, sleeping bags, blankets, bubble wrap, whatever. Patient goes on top of that, and then everything wraps around the patient, burrito rolls them. And we see that in, you know, Salt Lake Fire, but they come in wrapped up in, you know, yellow plastic. And that insulation plus an impervious barrier will really help reduce heat loss. If they're cold and you want to warm them, the thing you can do also before you wrap them up is put something warm in there with them. So the warm packs that go in the armpits and groin that we'll talk about, warm oxygen, warm fluids, and they can be wrapped up with these warm packs so that heat stays in with them and stays insulated. And then transport them. Obviously, bring them somewhere that they can be effectively rewarmed. Once people get severely hypothermic, you're probably not going to get them adequately rewarmed in the field. They need to come somewhere they can be actively rewarmed, which we'll talk about. And when you transport them carefully. Rubbing skin doesn't warm people up and does cause more damage due to frostbite and might induce V-fib, so that's not recommended. So let's talk about rewarming. Passive rewarming and active rewarming are sort of the two kinds of rewarming, and then active is broken down into external and internal. So we'll talk about passive rewarming first. It's called passive external rewarming, and that basically is insulating people. It works for mild hypothermia, so you have to be able to warm yourself basically to sort of get passively rewarmed. But it's also something we do for more severe hypothermia. As we actively rewarm people, we also insulate them. And we just talked about that, how to accomplish that. So pretty much anybody you bring in from the cold, especially if they're shivering, these are people that have mild hypothermia. They need to get insulated and wrapped up, their wet clothing off, and be in a warm environment so they don't become more severely hypothermic. So active external rewarming. I just found all these like historical references I thought were just kind of cool. So the first written reference to active external rewarming is reported to be in the Bible, actually. King David was hypothermic, and they tried to passively rewarm him by covering him with clothes, but he, quote, got no heat here. So then they found a fair damsel that they put in the blankets with them and heated them up, and that's sort of the first, you know, two people in the sleeping bag kind of thing. And I guess if you're a king, it's a fair damsel. Everybody else, you know, it's your kind of stinky climbing partner. But that does work. So that was sort of the first report of it. Some other reports, some of the survivors in Napoleon's invasion of Russia were reported to have climbed inside of warm horse carcasses. So this precedes the Call of the Wild and the idea of sticking your hands in the cut-open poor doggy. Apparently, it was not 100% effective, because here's a quote from a Russian infantry commander who saw somebody frozen dead inside the dead horse. So that may not be the best way, but yeah, that's kind of interesting. So anyway, active external rewarming. So when patients aren't producing heat, so they're moderately hypothermic or worse, they're not shivering, their heart rate hasn't been able to stay increased, they're not breathing faster, they're not able to make voluntary muscle contractions, they're sort of not making their own increased heat, now we've got to warm them up. So pre-hospital strategies, if you're going to give them IV fluids, warm IV fluids are good, cold IV fluids are bad. It'd be nice if we could give them pretty warm IV fluids. This obviously is going to depend on your department's protocols. I don't, you know, want you telling you guys to do stuff that isn't part of your protocols. But 41 to 45 degree Celsius fluids are recommended for this. Up to 65 degrees Celsius has been reported safe and has increased effectiveness compared to the lower temperatures. They've done a bunch of dog studies where they inject this hot saline in to people, the dog's vena cavas, and then look for any damage or coagulation injury and stuff, and basically nothing bad happens. So warm fluid is good. It's been suggested, and I've actually done this, you can microwave fluid. Again, I would never tell you guys to do something that's not part of your protocols, but it is reported that you can microwave IV fluids. And then mix it so you don't have some hot and some cold in there. When I was a volunteer paramedic in New Jersey, we used to throw the bags of fluid on top of the heaters in our call room at night, at least so it would be not cold when we gave it to patients. I don't know how many agencies still are using LR, but it's reported not to give lactate ringer because people's livers also shut down and they can't metabolize the lactate and just give them an acidosis. So actually D5 half normal saline is generally recommended because people have a sugar need, or just normal saline is fine as well. And I've seen recommended, you know, 500 to 1,000 cc bolus, and then running people at a couple hundred cc's an hour of fluid. But warm IV fluid, that's a good strategy to give some heat to people. Warmed oxygen is also recommended and supposed to be fairly effective. And at the very least, if you put people on oxygen, if it's warm oxygen, they lose less heat, because you can lose a lot of heat as you breathe. It's a really good heat conductor, your lungs are. And again, 42 to 44 degrees is recommended as the right temperature. Most of the little yellow humidifiers that you may have only go up to about 39 degrees. That's better than nothing. If you're able to warm the oxygen, that's good. Warm packs, so everybody can pretty much do this. These are easy. They come in those little things you break, and they warm up really fast. They actually can give a lot of heat, and some of them last 6 to 8 hours. Armpits and groin are the places to put these, and we'll talk about trying to warm the trunk and not the extremities. In general, it's good to put them in a pillowcase, a towel, a sheet, something, because I have seen people burned by these things when they're left on exposed skin. So some thin layer to keep them from burning the patient. But definitely you can put these in people's armpit and groin area, over their trunk, over their chest. It's also been suggested, it's not going to warm it up real well, but it's going to help keep IV fluids warm if you're for a prolonged time out in a cold environment, especially for people that are doing backcountry rescue, for example, is that you can tape these around IV fluid bags, and that heat will at least keep that IV fluid somewhat warm. And this may be more for flight crews and so forth, but warm force air bear huggers are really effective in warming people. And then just making sure the heat's turned up in the back of your ambulance. You should be sweating because you want your patients to stay warm. And it's also for us in the trauma bays and stuff in the hospital. And if you do put all this warm stuff on patients, then insulate them. Wrap them up in bubble wrap and blankets and all sorts of stuff, especially when you're moving them from the field to the rig, in a cold rig, and from the rig to the emergency department. So this is really easy stuff to do. This is really important stuff to do. And then this isn't stuff we're going to do in the field, just so you guys sort of know what happens in the hospital. Active internal rewarming, there's a variety of techniques. They're all fairly effective. Everywhere from cardiopulmonary bypass, so like they do for people getting heart transplants and stuff. They can actually take the blood out, warm it up, and put it back. Dialysis, a lot of hospitals can do hemodialysis for kidney failure patients, a very effective way to rewarm people, and something that a lot of hospitals are used to doing. And there's a variety of other warming circuits. And then more simple stuff that actually works really well is putting in chest tubes and running warm fluid through it, putting catheters in the peritoneum and running warm fluid. It sort of depends on your local hospital's resources, but there are ways to actively warm people, and these will warm people fairly quickly. So, yeah, that's kind of interesting. There's been talk about NG lavage and bladder lavage. The concern with NG lavage is maybe inducing some arrhythmias. Bladder lavage, so putting a Foley in and warm fluid in the bladder, has been reported. From what I've read, neither of those are really all that effective in warming people. The most effective ways, besides invasive rewarming, or as far as like bypass type rewarming, is invasive rewarming, either thoracic, which putting a chest tube in the second intercostal space, and then one down in the fourth or fifth intercostal space, and just running 45 degree temperature saline through it, or doing it with a peritoneal dialysis catheter or a DPL catheter. Those are effective. A lot of people, however, will rewarm just fine with active external rewarming. Like that lady that was 28 degrees, we thought about internally rewarming her. She was actually picking up a degree or two an hour with the bear hugger, warm fluids, and humidified oxygen. So we definitely do these things, especially people in cardiac arrest will do these things. But the invasive ones are the most effective in that situation. So. Okay, so what about afterdrop? I don't know if anybody's heard about afterdrop, but I always was taught to be really terrified of this afterdrop. We're going to warm people up, and they're going to get colder, and they're going to die. So, again, Napoleon's surgeon sort of first described this phenomena. People that were really cold, they put closest to the fire, died, and people that were a little further away didn't, and so people theorized this was an afterdrop phenomena. Who knows? Maybe the sicker ones got put closer to the fire, too. I don't know. But the theory is, as you get really cold, you sort of vasoconstrict, and blood sort of sits in your extremities. And so you warm up your extremities, that vasodilates the extremity, opens up the blood vessels, and all that cold blood suddenly rushes back to the center of the body, and that cold blood can make your core temperature colder, induce V-fib, and so forth. So this probably does happen. It's probably easily avoided by preferentially rewarming the trunk. So when we put our heat packs on people, we put them in their armpits, their groin, over their chest. And doing that, and then insulating people, and even throwing a bear hugger on people, rates of 2.5 Celsius degrees an hour increase have been reported without any complications. So, yeah, it can happen. Probably the best strategy is sort of the simple ones we talked about, using the armpits, using the groin, maybe the chest wall, and you're going to be fine. So I guess I don't worry about it too much. Okay, so that was all the background. Now to some kind of more directed treatment stuff. So ACLS care, ABCDE, so A, airway. If you need to intubate people, you should intubate people. The general approach that you're most used to is the recommended one, which is laryngoscope and orally intubating people. It maybe difficult due to jaw rigidity. So something think about, people's tissues get stiff when they're cold. And so you're going to have to fight that. It's maybe not because they're not paralyzed, for anybody that's in an environment that does RSI. And interestingly, paralytics don't really work when people get severely hypothermic. So this may be tough, but it's worth a try. Nasal intubation is reported, but the caveat with this is it's also reported that people may bleed profusely from this because their coagulation is all messed up. Remember, we talked about that. So I'm not saying not to do it, but you got to sort of bear that in mind. I'd be careful with it. And, you know, if you can't orally intubate them, I guess really think, can you bag them till you get them to the hospital or not? Because if you can, that may be the best approach rather than trying to nasally intubate somebody that's going to, you know, then hemorrhage. For the agencies that have, like, the King LT airways or other less invasive airways, it's a good option. It's easy to put in. It's going to be less manipulation needed. You don't necessarily need to get their mouth as wide open. The EOAs or LMAs are also in this kind of class of airways and are probably a really very good option, even as a first option. If you need to crike somebody and that's in your scope, that may be a very reasonable thing to do. If you can't get their mouth open and they're not breathing, they need their airway protected, you know, that's something that you're going to be able to do fairly easily. And then again, it's been said, as long as you oxygenate people, you put them on oxygen, you mass ventilate them beforehand, intubating somebody has not been associated with ventricular fibrillation, so it's okay to intubate people. It's not okay to make them severely hypoxic where you're trying for a long time if their jaw is really stiff. Probably better to mass ventilate them. So B, breathing. So a lot of people are breathing really slowly. Some people have suggested maybe they don't need to breathe real fast because their metabolism has slowed down. It's recommended to assist this. More oxygen is better for people. But to avoid overventilating people and really causing big acid-base changes in these folks. So one breath every 5 seconds, you know, your normal bagging rate. It may be tough because their chest walls can be very stiff, so you may feel like they have a lot of pressure to bag, and that's okay. You have to get a good seal. Probably need an oral airway in if you're able to do that. Remember, the nasal airways may cause bleeding, so you're probably better with an oral pharyngeal airway. And at the very least, put them on, you know, non-rebreather high-flow oxygen and preferably warmed oxygen, as we talked about, if you can. Oops, wrong way, sorry. Okay, circulation. So that's the big one, long pulse check, 30 to 45-second pulse check. These people are very bradycardic. They may not be in cardiac arrest, and if they have a pulse with a 30 to 45-second pulse check, then they don't need CPR with that. Different than people that are not cold, because that's probably all they need to circulate. So if they have a pulse, they're doing well, but you got to check for a while. If you're putting ECG pads on, they may not want to stick because their body's so cold. Benzoin, if you guys carry it, tincture of benzoin has been reported to be pretty effective for making them stick. I'm sorry, also small needles, like a 22 gauge or a 25 gauge needle, just push through the pad. And obviously you don't want to like impale people, but to stick the needle into the skin have been used to get these things to pick up. Again, something to make sure your agency has in its protocols or not. And is allowable, but otherwise these EKG pads may not stick. You may have better luck with the big pads with more adhesive, so the defib pads, that may be good enough just to get a rhythm on these people. IV access, obviously everybody needs IV access. It's going to be hard if they're hypothermic because they have no veins, and they're hard to get veins to pop up because they're not pushing blood to their extremities. So you put the tourniquet on to block the outflow, but there's no inflow because nothing's really moving around. The veins aren't going to engorge. I would have a very low threshold for just throwing an IO in people, an interosseous line, if that's in your protocols, because that's easy, it's fast, it's not going to be any more difficult because they're cold, and so it's a really good option to use. Warm IV fluids, at least not cold. It's good to make sure your fluids, you brought them from your call room into the rig with you, didn't just give them fluids that have been sitting in your rig outside all night, because that's not going to be good for them. We talked about careful handling. CPR, so if they need CPR because they got no pulse, they need CPR. People are going to be harder to do CPR on if they're severely hypothermic. Their tissues are very stiff, so you're going to have to use more force than you're used to. And I know like we're really trying to encourage frequent rescuer change for CPR in general. I know a lot of times we're bad about it because we think, oh, I'm doing it. I don't want to ask somebody else to help out. You should change people frequently because you're going to get tired. You're not going to give good compressions because their chest wall is so stiff. Okay, so, and then modifications to the ACLS protocol. So this is really easy. We're going to remember this 30-degree temperature and severe hypothermia is only like big modifications, but we'll talk about the mild and moderate also. So the mild and moderate people, so people that are cold to the touch, they've been out, they're getting ACLS, if you can measure their temperature and you're pretty sure they're not severely hypothermic, then you can do normal ACLS. The only differences are try to warm them up. And then they recommend increasing the spacing of your medicines because they're not metabolized as fast, but they don't really tell you what that means. So what I would say is that you go more towards the longer end. So like for a 3 to 5 minute med, maybe be thinking 5 minutes, 7 minutes, 8 minutes, something a little longer between your epi doses and atropine and so forth. Not a big change. The problem is a lot of times you're not going to know how hypothermic people are. I mean, if you're doing ACLS on somebody and they're cold, you probably want to assume that they're probably in this less than 30 degree temp. These are people found outdoors, cold to the touch. You're doing CPR on them because they got no pulse or they got V-fib. Kind of consider they may be severely hypothermic. And so the changes for this are D-fib's probably not effective, but we don't know exactly what temperature they're at. So one attempt at defibrillation is recommended. So you go ahead and attempt it, but attempt it once. If it doesn't work, there's no sense in attempting it more and more until they're warmer. What they need is oxygen, circulation, CPR, and then they need to be warmed up for this to work. So you got to get them somewhere you can get them warmed. They recommend no drugs, and the reason for that is the drugs don't work, and you give them a whole bunch of epi. Now they have 10 milligrams of epi. It's just sitting there. You warm them up. It all comes into the circulation, and now it's this sort of disaster once they're resuscitated because they keep on going into V-fib and V-tac from the epi, and they're vasoconstricted, and their brain doesn't get perfused, and on and on. So drugs are recommended against. Pacing doesn't work, so it's sort of a don't waste your time with it kind of thing. It's not going to hurt them. It's just not going to help. And then don't stop CPR until people are at least 32 degrees because they're not, that's the whole thing, right? They're not dead till they're warm and dead. We'll talk about this in a second. But a lot of these people are miraculously resuscitated when they're warmed up. So the trick is to give them good CPR and get them somewhere they can get warmed up. And I think anybody that works in a cold environment ought to be able to measure people's temperatures because this is a big change in ACLS. And I think it's very useful to be able to measure a core temperature in somebody, or at least a good guess at it. Even if all you have is a tympanic thermometer. So the skin temp and the tympanic temperatures are not going to be reliable as doing a rectal temp, possibly an oral temp, although these people you can't do that in. At the same time, if they have a skin temp in the 20s, they're probably severely hypothermic if everything else fits in. But it is true that temperature will be lower than their core temperature. Degrees, yeah. Okay, I will believe that. Thanks, Russ. So outcome in these folks, kind of difficult to predict and difficult to study. So it's been reported that people have between 40 and 75% mortality for severe hypothermia. That's pretty bad. On the other hand, that means up to half of people maybe will survive severe hypothermia. This isn't necessary for people in cardiac arrest. This is just for people less than 30 degrees. Likely this depends on the underlying cause. So if they're hypothermic because they're also septic and have a bad infection and had a huge heart attack or 80% body surface area burns, they're going to have a higher mortality. If they're hypothermic because they're young, otherwise healthy, and were stuck outside overnight, they're going to be better off. But here's some sort of interesting and encouraging things. Survival has been reported in an infant, so a 23-month-old infant, down to 15 degrees Celsius. That's 59 degrees Fahrenheit. I mean, that's cold. Right? And in adults, almost the same. And there's also a reported case of survival after 6.5 hours of CPR. And I think this case was actually a physician that got cardiopulmonary bypass, and the whole resuscitation was like 9 hours, and the patient survived neurologically intact. So it's worth trying. That doesn't mean most people are going to survive, but gosh, it's worth giving people a shot at it. And here's the last thing. This one's kind of hard to figure out sometimes, but it depends if the patient's cold because they're dead, or they're dead because they're cold. So if they're cold because they're dead, they died, and then they were left out overnight, they're not going to survive. Or if they drowned and were asphyxiated and then got cold because they were in the water, they're not going to survive. On the other hand, if they got cooled, like they were buried under the snow and they were able to breathe for 20 to 30 minutes with their air pocket and then got hypothermic and arrested in an avalanche, or if they were immersed and cooled even though they were able to keep their head above water and then became apneic, those people have a much better chance at being resuscitated. Problem is, we just don't know which one they are, so we got to kind of try our best to treat everybody till we figure it out. Okay, that's it. Any questions? Am I ahead of schedule, I hope? Excellent. All right, thanks, everybody. All right.